Good afternoon. My name is Kevin, and I'm a graduate student at LSU, working with Professor John Dowling. And today I want to present about my work with Rajveer Nehra, also a graduate student at the University of Virginia. And before I start, I want to thank the organizers of this event for giving me an opportunity to talk. So my work is about characterizing detectors. Before I start, I will give a brief introduction to the subject. I will then detail the method that I use. And then I will explain the proposed experimental setup that is required to do this. I will also show you the results of a numerical simulation of how this helps us to model a perfect and an imperfect photon number solving detector. And finally, I will conclude. So my aim is to characterize photodetectors. And in quantum mechanics, we have postulates dealing with what the quantum state is, how they evolve, and how you find out things about the state. And whenever we have a quantum detector, you can describe it by a set of POVM elements. And these are operators which add up to the identity operator and uniquely characterize any measurement device. And whenever you have such a POVM element, if you have to measure a quantum state rho, then the probability P of getting an outcome K corresponding to the POVM element MK is just the trace of rho times the POVM element. And this, my friend Sanjay Lohani also showed this in his talk on quantum state estimation. So from this basic formula, if the state is what is unknown and the measurement device is known, then we can use this relation to obtain probabilities, and we can use it in turn to characterize the quantum state. And we heard a talk about that in the morning. And in contrast, conversely, if the state is what is known, we can use this above relation to find out the POVM set of a detector. And in this talk, I will be interested in characterizing photodetectors, and that is by obtaining the phase space description of its POVM elements. And I will explain what it is. And before I do that, let me talk briefly about Wigner functions. Wigner functions are quasi-probability distributions in phase space, and it is used to describe operators in phase space. And Wigner functions are a unique description of these operators. And if you have the Wigner functions of a POVM set, that completely describes your detector. And for a phase insensitive detector, these Wigner functions in the phase space are rotationally symmetric around z-axis. So we are talking about a single mode detector into which if a state is input, then the output does not depend upon the coherence elements of the state. So it is insensitive to phase elements. And for such detectors, the functions of POVM elements are rotationally symmetric around the z-axis, and so they can be characterized on the real line alone. And that's what I will mainly focus for the purposes of this talk. And our aim is to develop a method to obtain the Wigner functions of the P of M elements of an unknown detector. And for this, we will use a particular representation of the Wigner function. It is equivalent to the standard definition of the Wigner function. And it is, the Wigner function is defined as an infinite sum of a displaced number state n. So it's an infinite sum with a displacement operator acting on the number state n. And this formula lends itself to be exploited, and I will explain how. If we have to find out the Wigner function corresponding to a P of M element Mk, we just take the trace of the element Mk with the Wigner function operator. And so you can carry the trace inwards, and it's the trace of this quantity that we have here. And if you notice it, it is the probability p of a state of definite photon number n displaced by alpha being detected with the POVM element mp. And we will develop a method to find out these kinds of things, these numbers. And so for practical purposes, we find that most of the terms after a few initial terms are negligible for some of the cases that we considered. And so it can be written as a finite sum going from 0 to n0 of these terms that I described before. And so our approach is for each point in phase space, find out these terms, and then put them back in the summation, you find out the Wigner function at that point. And because it's because the Wigner function is rotationally symmetric around the z-axis, you just need to find out the Wigner function along the radial line. And so we can find the Wigner function at multiple points, and that will characterize the P of M element. And so for this, we use n0 plus 1 thermal mixture test probes. So n0 is the upper limit that we keep of the summation, and we use the number of terms in the summation. So if you need more accurate result, you use more different thermal mixtures as probes. And the probes are labeled with the superscript J, and Pn is the probability that the probe has n photons. I must also emphasize that this technique works for any probe which is diagonal in the fog basis. So how do we do it? So if you send such a probe onto the detector, then the probability, and here I use Q because I have too many P's, the probability of getting an outcome K from the detector when the jth probe is used is a sum over photon numbers with the probe having n photons, and the probability that the detector clicks after an n photon displaced by alpha is sent to it. So I will explain further. When you have different probes, or n0 plus 1 number of probes, you can write this equation in the form of a matrix. So for the subscripts, the superscripts in the brackets label the probes that you use, and the column vector on the left is the measured statistics that we get from the detector. The matrix, it characterizes the probes that we sent in, and so these two are known, and what is unknown is these values, capital P's. And once we have those values, we can plug it back in in our formula and characterize the detector. And so simply put, you can write this as a matrix equation where Q labels the left-hand side, P labels the matrix of which characterizes the probes that we sent in, and pi is our unknown probabilities. And for solving this, we have a convex optimization problem. So we minimize the 2 norm of Q minus P pi, and it is subject to certain constraints that the probability distributions should obey. So pi is between 0 and 1, or all the elements are between 0 and 1 because there are probabilities. And here also, since p's are probabilities, a weighted sum such like this lies between minus 1 and 1. And if we solve this, we can obtain the Wigner function at one particular phase space point. And if we do this for multiple phase space points, then we can characterize the detector. And let me show you the setup that we proposed. The experiment to do this hasn't yet started, but it is planned to be done at the University of Virginia. It consists of a laser beam being split at a beam splitter, and one part goes towards the generation of these thermal mixtures, and the other part goes for displacing these thermal mixtures. So you have one of the beams in order to generate thermal mixtures passing through a variable neutral density filter and going through a rotating ground glass so as to generate thermal mixture. And the other beam going through a local oscillator modulator. And then we have a displacement beam splitter, which is a highly transmissive beam splitter, so that we can perform the displacement operation. And finally, this falls on the detector. And we measure the statistics coming from the detector. And in order to find how this would work in principle, we numerically simulate our method for a perfect and an imperfect photon number resolving detector. A perfect photon number resolving detector is a detector in which if n photons are input, will output n. So it will perfectly tell you the number of photons that hits on it. An imperfect photon number resolving detector doesn't do that. And it can be modeled by putting a beam splitter before a perfect beam splitter. Perfect. A photo number resolving detector. And for this, consider 51 points in phase space on the real line, and we consider 50 thermal states with different mean photon numbers. And these are our simulated results. The top shows the results for a perfect photon number resolving detector, and the bottom shows those for a detector with 90% efficiency. The red lines are the ideal detectors or the theoretically calculated what should have been the POVM elements, and the blue dots are what are found out by this numerical simulation. And you can see that the dots are in agreement with the red line. I have to point two particular things about this plot. One is that we see the effects of finite efficiency, and that is seen by, say, for example, for a POVM element for detecting zero photons, the highest point for a perfect detector is above 0.6, whereas it is below 0.6 for an imperfect detector. And so you can see similar results in for one photon and two photon POVM elements. And the second thing that we note is that the ends of the POVM elements that we calculate are not smooth. So you see here some kind of wiggle pattern. And this let us ask two questions. Can we reproduce such spurious patterns? And also, more importantly, can we reduce the number of points in phase space that we probe? In particular, do we have to scan each point in phase space? And the answer to it is, if we have some prior knowledge about the detector, say that it saturates for some fixed number of photons, that it cannot detect more than that particular number of photons, then we can exploit this into reducing the number of points in phase space that we probe, as well as smoothening out our reconstructed Wigner functions. So, as I said, the number of points probed in phase space can be reduced if we have prior information about the detector. And for phase insensitive detector, which saturates at the photon number M0, then the Wigner function is a Gaussian modulated polynomial of degree 2m0 plus 1. So if we know the degree of a polynomial, then we can use techniques to fit our few obtained points to a polynomial of that degree. And so here what we did is we considered an imperfect single photon detector which saturated 5 photons, and we found the Wigner function at 11 points, and we obtained a Gaussian modulated polynomial fit, and the blue line is our fit, whereas the red line is what would have happened if we had kept, say, a large number of terms in the summation, say 15. So we see these spurious wiggly patterns would disappear. So let me conclude. We have developed a method to characterize photodetectors by obtaining the POPM element spectra functions. And we have simulated this for photon number resolving detector. And we have shown that if we have prior knowledge about the detector, this can be used to simplify the procedure to characterize the Wigner function.
Yeah, so you showed the slide with the optimization, and I was curious about the choice of the 2 norm. Is that for mathematical convenience?
We don't have any particular reason why we use the 2 norm.
Okay. I was trying to think about it. So like, when we compare probability distributions, we use trace distance. We use variational distance. When we compare quantum states, we use trace distance. But Wigner functions, what should you use to compare them? They can go negative, right? So they're not really probability distributions.
Yes, and also the things that we calculate pi here are a list of probabilities. So they're not really Wigner. We are not really obtaining Wigner functions from this optimization. After the optimization, we get this.
You invert the matrix.
After we do this optimization, we get a column vector pi, and we sum the elements of pi, say like pi 0 minus pi 1 plus pi 2 minus pi 3, and that is the Wigner function.
Yeah.
So we are not sure what norm each use, but this works.
Yeah. I have more questions. I don't know if other people have questions.
I have a comment. I think this is a least square regression that reached regularization. Like this, because the thing you are minimizing to norm, you use just least square, like linear regression.
Yeah. So other observations. In 2012, Rob Speckens, with a co-author, had this long paper, and at the end he talks about Wigner function of a quantum channel. And that was something we talked about in the Gaussian quantum information course. Right? And so I was wondering if you thought about extending these ideas to characterize quantum channels. Right, so like you were saying this morning, we heard about state tomography from Sanjay, and here this is like measurement tomography.
Yes.
And then you could look even further to channel tomography. It might be an interesting direction.
Yes, I haven't thought about it, but I have done some work on process tomography, but that is not from an information theory point of view. But I think I should look into it.
Okay. The other question I had was on you were showing some plots in like maybe 2 slides from now or 3 slides. Yeah. So I was looking at these carefully, and looks like for n=0, you have a nice, you said it was a 90% efficient detector.
I think this was,
right?
Yeah.
The bottom. So like we see n=0, pretty good overlap, and then n=1, pretty good overlap, but then it starts degrading, like the peaks, for n equals 2.
Yes.
Does that continue? Does the overlap like get worse and worse as n gets larger?
I think so. That the reason is if a detector is, say, 90% efficient, then it is 0.9 square efficient for detecting 2 photons and cube for detecting 3 photons. And I think that's the reason why.
Right. Okay. Yeah, it's very interesting.
I had a pretty basic question. What are these graphs? What are the x and y axes?
These are the weak functions.
So
the x axis is q, and b is kept to be 0. So these are the quad.
It's like a 2D slice.
It's like it is a 2D plot, and on the y axis I plot the actual Wigner function.
Okay.
So if you were to rotate these Wigner functions in 3 dimensions, then you would see the actual 3 dimensional Wigner functions.
Yeah. But because it's phase invariant,
yes.
It suffices just to look at this.
Yeah, so it's like a cross section.
Rotation.
Okay, yes.
Yeah.
So I keep wanting to somehow interpret these as probabilities. It's, you know, I'd see the n equals 0, and it's got a nice spike at 0. Tend to see 0 photons, occasionally you see 1. Am I on the right track here? I see some negative numbers, which kind of throws me off a little bit.
Negativity is a signature of quantumness.
Yeah.
And these number states are highly non-Gaussian states.
Yeah. And so we can think of like a detector which detects only, say, 1 photon is a quantum detector. Nothing classical can detect exactly 1 photon.
So like it would see the photon if there's exactly 1 photon. If there was 2 photons, it would be like, I don't see anything. You're saying?
Well, so there is a POVM set which characterizes a detector. So the what I have shown on top were for a detector which is perfectly able to discriminate between photon numbers. So its POVM elements would be 0, 0, 1, 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, and so on. But in the bottom, you would have, say for this, the POVM element would be mostly 0, 0, but it will have some contribution from higher terms like 1, 1. And even this for this one, it would be mostly 1, 1, but it would have contributions from other terms as well.
So, we're using this to characterize photodetectors whose ideal elements are number states, but it seems like you could turn your head and think about this as also characterizing photon sources,
sure.
Right? Like flipping from Heisenberg picture to Schrodinger picture. Could your optimization program be used to analyze how good to like characterize a photon number source? It's more open than.
We have a perfect, say, photon number resolving detector, and you have, say, photon source which, say, some mostly emits vacuum and sometimes emits a single photon and rarely emits 2 photon. Then we would be able to probably find out these probabilities with which it emits 0 photons and 1 photon or 2 photon. So you can use a similar procedure to find out these probabilities.
Okay, maybe that's been done before? Or?
Not sure, I don't think so.
Okay.
But I'm not also sure if many people are interested in it.
Photon sources? I would say so.
In photon sources, yes, but by using this method, because I do not know if there might be an advantage.
Okay, but there's something to look into. Maybe it's some easy cheese to grill.
I mean, people might not be interested because they don't know about this method.
Are the solutions for PMP alpha, like, are they unique because of this, the way you optimize it? Like sometimes, like, the condition number for matrix is large enough that you don't get unique solutions.
So, what I can say is they did this for many times and they always converge to the same results, but we don't have any theoretical basis for savings. What I know is it works, but I don't exactly rigorously justify why it works.
Nice. Would you see any difference if you put P not equal to zero, say, that would correspond to like a moving detector? Would that be any better or worse?
Could you repeat your question?
Here you've put P equal to zero.
Oh, yeah.
Yes. What if you move the detector?
What if I move the detector?
Yeah, then P won't be equal to zero.
So it's Q and P are not labels of the detector position. Is that what you're asking?
Position,
rotational coordinate, right?
It's the coordinates of the Wigner function in phase space.
Yeah, so P is the momentum.
Not PQ as phase space variable.
So it's not the classical phase.
Okay.
It's
that's what I thought too.
Yeah.
Yeah, the
so
phase
PEQ, I got
the
it.
The photons, like not the classical position and momentum, but it's kind of like it. It's like P.
It's off by the. Oh, yeah.
It's like
it
A plus A dagger, and then the other one
it's
is.
It's electric field.
Yeah, that electric field.
If you look at many textbooks, they would have this very nice picture of wiggly 3D plots of photons, say Gaussian item. I think it is front cover. It shows you a picture of a photon, and it shows you some squeezed light also. So it is in that space that we are working.
I guess if there's no other questions.